So first thing is necessary knowledge. So if you know your text rules, you can score well. But the problem is that there are abundance of rules. And the basic requirement of the previous exam, ACCA TX and ATX. So lots of rules, lots of information, difficult to memorize, difficult to retain the knowledge at the exams day. This is a basic hurdle, right? And you have approximately a month, if I'm not wrong, approximately a month or so to just revise or cover the areas if you are not still covered the entire syllabus. But the main thing is that entire syllabus is to be covered, right? Entire syllabus, not the selected areas. Entire syllabus means all the areas covering income tax, corporation tax, capital gain tax, inheritance tax, and the value added tax, the five areas, right? So if a student is not have knowledge about income tax rules properly, like if a student has not learned that what is the exempt benefits under employment income, then obviously the student not able to get the marks. If examiner is asking about the exempt employment benefits, if examiner is asking about the NIC 2 and 4, and the student don't know how to calculate NIC 2 and 4, or the rules regarding NIC 1 employee or NIC 1 employer, then straight marks are there, but the student is not able to get that because the knowledge is missing, right? So what you are doing, I just need answer from each student. What you are doing to cover this knowledge? Or how much you have covered the syllabus portion? What is your best topic? What is your weaker area? Kindly just add something. Go ahead. I'm listening. Or you can type as well, but I'll prefer you just talk. Okay, chat, what is chat? Where is chat? Corporation tax. Okay, fine. Any other student? What is your strength? What is your weakness in overall syllabus? Which area is good? What about you, Oranima? Anything you want to add? IHT and CGT. Is this your weak areas or strong areas? Weakness is income tax. Okay. Income tax is your weakness, and your strong areas are IHT and CGT. Okay. That's very good, because IHT and CGT is a major portion in our syllabus. Okay. So what do you have to do? You have to do in the remaining time, work out on your weak areas, right? So that major areas would be your strong areas rather than weak areas. Try to learn the rules or necessary explanation about each rules, and for which you can use notes and something like that. Second thing is that the reason student not able to get the passing marks is poor examination technique. And you are here to learn the examination technique as well. How to attempt question, how to identify the requirement, what to write, how to write, right? This is the ultimate objective, to tell you that how information from the question can be extracted and what is the relevant writing material, how to write the relevant stuff that will provide you some marks, right? and sometimes both are the reasons. So this is basically the examination team's comment is that the student failed due to lack of necessary knowledge, poor examination technique, either or both. Few students have both lack of knowledge and poor examination techniques. Now the best thing is, if you want to know that what examiner expect from you, so is to review examiner reports of the last few attempts. Try to understand what examiner is saying, what is the expectation of the examiner, where student making mistake, where students are making mistakes. So what you have to do, you have to avoid that mistake if the student are making mistakes. So you have to avoid mistakes. So you have to work on these two things, resources, knowledge, examination techniques, right? Sometimes when a student score like the marginal marks, marginal failure, like for example, a student fails at the score of 45 to 49, then mainly is the reason of poor examination technique. And majority of the students, most of the students usually fall in this particular range. So they might not able to attempt the 100% paper because time constraint is a major issue. To complete the paper is very, very important that you can cover the whole paper. At least you can attempt the whole paper rather than leaving the 20 mark question or 15 mark question or 10 mark question. That would be a disaster for you, because the paper in terms of time management is very tough, and it's a challenge for the student to complete the 100 marks entirely in 3 hours and 15 minutes. I hope you agree with me on this time management. But if a student score like very low marks, like under 25, which happens as well, then lack of knowledge, then this is not the examination technique. This is pure lack of knowledge. So if you work on both lack of knowledge and examination technique, then you will cross the 50 marks limit. And if you are running out of time, what is this? If you are running out of time, if you are saying that I'm not able to attempt the 100% marks, 100% paper, then it means poor exam technique. It is not like that you are not able to attempt the 100% paper due to lack of knowledge. It's poor examination technique that you have spent more time on one question and not able to attempt a whole question in which there were few easy marks were there, like 5 to 10 marks are usually easy in every question. But due to the timing issues, a student usually might not able to attempt a full question or few parts of the question. And if you are struggle to come up with the answer or a wrong answer, then examiner is asking you X and you are giving them Y, then it means what? Lack of knowledge. Due to this lack of knowledge, you're not able to answer, or you're not able to answer it correctly. So we have to work on this. That is examination technique, which I'll be discussing throughout this session, and the necessary knowledge, which are what I've already told you. What is the knowledge? That is the text rules. Well, you people are not lucky enough, like ICAW exams, in which you are able to get all the resources with you, like examination books or teacher's notes or like that. Each and everything you can carry with you. And in this examination, the issue is that You have to memorize all the relevant tax issues, all the application of tax, whether it's income tax or VAT or IHT, overseas aspects or corporation, CGT, whatever. So all difficult to retain all the knowledge. And the best thing is to revise, revise many times so that you can learn, so that you can reproduce in your exam. Okay. Any question right now about this? If you want to ask or if you want to add something?
No, it's okay.
It's okay. Fine. Do you agree with me on this point?
Yes.
Okay, fine. Let's move on. Now. Okay, let's read the chat comment. Yes. Okay, fine. So let's move to the question, March 2020 exam question. I'm also discuss the current CBE exam portal or the paper specimen paper exam, but as few students are attempting the paper based exam. So right now I'm just focusing on the examination techniques or question requirement, right? So don't bother about the computer based exam. It is not just different, no? Manual exams or computer based exam. Just there is a difference of functionality. In paper-based exam, you have to attempt it on your paper or the answer sheet. And in a computer-based exam, the word processing documents and the Excel sheet will be provided you to either use the calculation or the explanation. So I'll be sharing this too as well, right? But first of all, I will sharing the manual exam format previously. So we have the paper that is Advanced Taxation UK, March 2020, right? This is the paper, right? And we'll discuss few questions in today's session from this particular paper. And we'll discuss how to tackle Section A, how to tackle Section B, which section is easy, which section is difficult, how to handle lots of information, how to extract the relevant information and the requirement, how to identify exactly what is being asked rather than writing each and everything that comes up in your mind. Okay. Remember that too much writing is not required. Only the selected writing, selected stuff is required. Whether you are writing it briefly, but if you are giving examiner the relevant points, then you will able to get maximum marks. So you can see that our paper comprises of two section. Section A comprises of two questions and Section B comprises of two questions, right? So for the 3 hours and 15 minutes, we have two questions from Section A and we have two questions from Section B, and there is no choice, unfortunately. And you will be provided a tax rates and allowance sheet on manual exam as well and on CB exam as well, right?
Just me an explanation.
Are you asking anything? Okay. Now, move along, right? So this is the paper. Okay, this particular paper, March 2020, is based on FA18. But we will solve this paper as per FA19, right? Whatever is the calculation or whatever is the rules, we'll apply from the perspective of the FA19 exam. But on the ACCA website, the paper is based on FA18 rather than FA19, right? So the solution that is on the ACCA website is irrelevant. I will share the solution, or I will solve the question, so we'll get the answer from my solution. So this is the text sheet. You will get a text sheet, right? There are text rules regarding residence, regarding income tax, personal allowance, residence, remittance charges, employment, pension, allowances, corporation, VAT, IHT, taper relief, CGT rates, national insurance contribution, and some penalties and stamp duty, right? So this is the examination beginning from section A. So we know that section A, there are two questions. The first question is always a huge one. This first question comprises of how many marks? The first question comprises of 35 marks, right? And in the CB exam, the pattern will remain the same. Remember, there is no change in the examination pattern, in the course, in the syllabus. Each and everything will be as per the previous structure. The only change is how you attempt as per the functionality. Okay. So this is the first question carrying 35 marks, including 4 marks for 4 professional marks. And this is the only question in which 4 professional marks are available. And what is that 4 marks? It is all about the answer, the clarity of the explanation, the communication, effectiveness of communication, presentation in style. That might give you 4 marks if you present your answer well. You can see that there are 4 requirements, but you can see that as far as information is concerned, there are lots of information in this 35 marks question. And it happens with the students that they consume a lot of time in question number 1 that result in they are not able to complete the paper. So what you have to avoid, spending a lot of time on question number 1 specifically, right? You have to identify from question number 1 the relevant requirement, what you know, the knowledge area, and attempt only that part which you know well, so that you cannot spend time enough on question 1. Rather than we have to attempt more question 2, 3, and 4 as well. The question 2, you can see from the paper, question number 2, again, question number 2's weightage is like lots of information, and the question number 2 weightage is 25 marks. So one is 35 marks, and the second one from section A is 25 marks. So total is 60 marks. 60 marks from section A. Student is asking a question. I'm not good on writing. I will write the answer, but then don't know where to start. You will learn from this session that what to write, what not to, right? So just focus on this session. You will able to learn few examination techniques that you can apply. Kindly, if you have some background noise, or if someone is talking behind you, then kindly just mute yourself. And then if you have to ask question, then unmute and then ask any question from me. Okay. So that the recording will not be disturbed. Otherwise, there will be disturbance in recording. Okay, let's move along. So this is 60 marks section A. Now, one important question is that I'm asking a question from you. Do you think that is it a right strategy to start from the section A or from the sequence? Is it a right way to follow the sequence? That is question number 1 complete, then question number 2, then 3, then 4. What do you think about it? I'm just asking you. I'll tell you that What is my point on that? What I feel is better for the student? What do you think? Is it a wise strategy to start from question number one? Not necessarily. Not advisable. It's not advisable from my side. Now, the teachers might have different view on that, but my view is that it is not advisable to start from question one. Why? Because it has lots of information. So you might be confused in starting the paper. So it's not advisable to start from section A, question number one, until and unless that you don't know other than question number one. Then what is the option left? You have to start from question number one. But if you know a few parts, if you know the answer of few parts from question number 3, 4, 2, then it is advisable not to start from question number one of section A, right? So this is the tip number one. If you follow that tip, you will not regret. Okay, let's move to question number 3. We'll start from section B. Practice. We'll start our practice from section B question. Not necessarily. Okay, thank you. Fine. So, question number 3 and 4, although compulsory, but the requirement is quite straight. The question marks are 20 marks each. So the data is not so much, right? You can see just one page data. So the advantage is that you can easily handle the information, right? From question number 3, and you can see the requirement, and then we'll move to question number 1, to question number 4, and you can see just one page information, and the requirement is also in the same page. So you can see that limited information. Clear requirement, limited information. So ideally, my suggestion is that when you attempt your paper, start from section B, attempt at least one question from section B first, right? If you know, right? The condition is that if you know the relevant points. So let's move to, we'll start from this session from question number 4, right? So let me just copy this question on my worksheet, because right now I'm just doing it manually. Okay. And in the subsequent practice session, I will practice few computer based calculations and explanation as well. Is it fine? Right? This I'm just telling for the students, those who are attempting it on CB based. So this is the question that I have to attempt. I have to identify. And this is the, oh, it's not like that. It's cut. So this is my question that I'm going to start. This is question number 4 from March 2020 exam. Assume that it's your September 2020 exam. Let's assume that it is your September 2020 exam and you are planning to attempt question number 4. You have already learned some text rules, okay? And you have to identify the requirement. You have to plan your answer, because planning is very important. You have to plan. You have to make some notes that what is the relevant point, what to write, what are the rules exactly that has been asked in the question. So this is the question number 4. Let me just first of all read the first paragraph. I always just read the first paragraph. It says what you have to do. Then I'll jump to the requirement of the question. The question says that Pedro requires advice on the reason he has had to pay inheritance tax. So the first issue is an inheritance tax issue as a result of death. Now, let me just ask one of you student, do you know what is the basic IHT issues? So there are two basic IHT issues. One is the lifetime transfer and other is the death state. And the rule says that during lifetime transfer, one is the PET, potentially exempt transfer, and other is the chargeable lifetime transfer. So we have to pay tax on chargeable lifetime transfer, but PET is exempt. But if donor dies within 7 years of making the gift, then PET is taxable as well as the CLT is also taxable, right? Am I right? This is the basic rule, right? So it might be possible that examiner is asking that basic rule. And if you know the basic rule, if you know how to calculate transfer of value, if you know the exemptions, if you know the nil rate band, and if you know the taper relief, then marks are there. You can get the marks if you know all these basic rules. So if you're not quite happy with your rules, then just go there, learn, memorize about these rules so that you can attempt the question. Now, the second issue So this particular issue is from IHT. Examiner is mixing the issues now. Examiner is not asking a full question on income tax, a full question on corporation, but examiner usually asks multiple tax issues in a single question, right? The second issue is you have to provide explanation about a furnished holiday lettings. Now, what is furnished holiday letting rule? In which topic you cover this rule? Any idea? Is it employment income? Or is it self-employment? Is it employment income or self-employment or property income? Which one is that? Property income. You are right. Correct. So if you are able to identify that this area is from property income, then it might be a chance that you can write few items, you can score few points, few marks easily, right? So one of the issue is the property income and furnished holiday lettings. So there are rules of furnished holiday lettings. And specifically, if a property is to be classified as a furnished holiday lettings, there are some rules. What are their rules? Maybe in the requirement, the examiner has asked these rules. The third thing is that the income tax implication of a personal pension contribution. Now, I'm just marking it down, the very important topic. I will separately provide you the important topic list in day 2 or 3 for this September exam, but just note it down. Pension contribution is one of the important examination topic, right? Note it down. So one IHT issue has been asked and two income tax related issues, one from property income and other from the chapter that is the pension income. Now, as far as the pension income is concerned, the rules are quite, there are few rules. There are few different rules. If I can recall the pension scheme. So there is, the question is being asked is personal pension scheme. So we know that there are occupational pension scheme. There are personal pension scheme. You should know the difference. You should know the tax treatment. That what is the tax treatment of occupational pension scheme? What is the tax treatment of personal pension scheme? If you are able to describe or calculate, then you can get the marks. Now let's move to the requirement. once I have identified that what examiner want to ask, I just recall the topic in my mind about IHT, about FHL, about PPS. Then I just go to the required. What I'm doing, I haven't started the writing. Remember, what is the student's habit? A student just go to the requirement and then start writing. Read the question first, and then you will start blindly. You don't have to write immediately. Just understand the question, requirement, the relevant stuff. Give 5 to 6 minutes, 7 minutes. Even you can take 8 minutes or so, and then plan your answer and then start your writing, right? This is the best way. Planning is the best way. Now let's move to the requirement. So there are three clear requirements. One is 5 marks. So that means not much you have to write. Another is 5 marks. Again, not much to write, five marks. But as far as this is concerned, a lot of marks. So the major focus of the question is on pension contribution part. Okay. So first question says that, do you have to calculate outright anything? No. The first question says that, explain the IHT rules related to gift of cottage. At the time when the gift was made during lifetime, its lifetime, and at the time of death. This is how you have to identify the requirement, that there are two requirements, that you have to explain the lifetime consequences and you have to explain the death consequences, right? So the marks, 5 marks is being divided into two parts. One is the lifetime implication. Implication means, what is the tax consequence? What is the tax rules, right? As particular to that. And the second is death state. But still, I don't know the, what is the information in the question. Is it a simply PAT or CLT? Or is there any something different in this part? But at least I know that the examiner is asking about lifetime gift, and examiner is asking about the gift as a result of death. Okay, fine. The second requirement, explain again. So I have to explain again. There is no calculation requirement has been asked directly. What you have to do now, just identify. You have to explain, and you have to explain with the relevant condition. If you miss that condition, and if you try to explain the property income or like that, you're not able to get the maximum marks. You have to state condition. You have to explain condition. Don't state. You have to explain condition. About what? The furnished holiday letting for the first 12 month of period. So there is a mnemonic: availability, actual letting period, and period of occupation. So this is a mnemonic of the rule. The availability of the property, the actual letting of the property, and the third one is what? The actual letting, long-term letting rule. So you can easily get 5 marks if you know the rules, right? Regarding property income, there is no calculation required whatsoever. You can explain your calculation in part A, that NRB is available, that it might be a 40% tax rate or so and so on, but do not, though no calculation is needed in A part or in B part, right? Now let's move to the C part, and then I will start solving the question. I'll read the question properly and then I will start. Now see, the examiner is straight asking what? There are, in the whole paper, you will see in few parts straight calculation. So if you know the calculation, just calculate and get the marks. So what you have to calculate? Calculate the reduction in income tax liability as a result of making contribution. Now just tell me, if you put, okay, I think you're not able to get the screen, right? 1 minute. Let me just reshare the screen. Do you have the screen, the question requirement, all of you? Anyone? Now listen, there is a point in personal pension contribution that is what? The extension of band. You know that basic band is to be extended by the amount of relief, right? So if you contribute more, what would be the consequence? If you contribute more, then what would be the consequence? Your band will increase. And when your band will increase, your liability will be reduced because you are applying now a lower rate as compared to a higher rate. Because the basic rate band is to be taxed non-saving income. The higher rate band is 40%. The additional rate band is 45% for non-saving income. So if you are extending the band, basic rate band and the higher rate band, then the income tax liability will be reduced. But the issue is that you do not have to explain. If you explain, fine enough, examiner is asking about the calculation. Examiner is not asking about the explanation. You have to find out the numbers. You have to identify the income tax liability. You have to calculate income tax liability. And if I'm not wrong, this is a ACCA fundamental F6 type of question. A 10 marks question in the ATX exam, but the level of difficulty is of F6 exam. So the students were very lucky. Those who got this particular requirement and not able to get marks, it's very unfortunate. Because examiner is giving you few easy marks in few questions. What you have to do? You have to get these easy marks. 10 out of 10. If someone is able to get 8, 7 or 6, I'm saying poor performance, because the area is not that much difficult. Okay. And your tutor or from college, you have got the regular session, or if you're self studying, the pension is always an important issue. Every student cover pension. There are lots of kit questions related to pension scheme. So you know that you have to just use that 10 marks. Okay. Now you have to calculate, plus there is another requirement. Now do not mix the additional, do not avoid the additional requirement. What do you have to do? Your answer should include an explanation. Now there is a bit explanation about what? The amount of personal allowance available to Pedro in this case. So can someone tell me what is the personal allowance rule? Is there any impact of contribution on personal allowance? If you put money in personal pension contribution, will it affect our personal allowance calculation? for tax year 1920, our initial personal allowance is, and this is subject to ANI of how much? $100,000. So if income exceeds $100,000, what is the rule? There will be reduction of PA. For example, let's assume that ANI is 110,000. So you know the calculation. Just find out the excess amount and divide it by 2 or make it half. So this is 5,000 reduction in personal allowances, right? So if this is the situation, then personal allowance will be reduced to, this is my example, right? This is not related to the question. I'm just explaining the point. 7,500. What is ANI? How we can calculate ANI? What is the formula of calculation of ANI? So this is the tax rule. I just told you in the initial beginning what is important. I'm just highlighting it again. What is important? Necessary knowledge. And this is what the knowledge. Net income. What to deduct? Should I add or deduct? Pension, right? So if I deduct pension, what would be the impact? If you contribute more, then your net income, your ANI will be reduced. So as a result, there are situations that you might not be able to get personal allowances. But if you put money in personal pension contribution, then it might be possible that you're able to get the 100% personal allowance. This is what the explanation, this is what you have to show in calculation, and this is what you have to explain to the examiner, that what is that. Clear? Now, one more thing related to this. Do you know that if your contribution or the amount of relief is greater than annual allowance, can anyone tell me what is this? If you are putting more contribution, what is the threat? Anyone, if you know the rule. There is a term called double A charge. So in this question, as we are putting more amount into pension contribution, there is a chance that you might create a double A charge. And if this is the situation, then what? You have to calculate tax on double A charge as well. And what is double A charge? Double A charge is to be treated as top slice of income. I mean, 2 or 3 days back, one of the student, which is right now not login, she asked me about the top slice of income. What exactly is the meaning of top slice of income? So do you know that? What is the meaning of top slice of income? If yes, then it's very good. Top slice of income is dividend? Not exactly. Now, I'm just making a point. Double A charge is to be treated as non-saving income. You have to apply the rate of non-saving income. But the meaning of top slice of income is still missing. What it means? So again, I'm making my point, try to cover the tax rules as effectively as possible so that when examiner is giving you easy marks, unfortunately, you will lose that marks if you don't know the rules. Top slice of income means consider double A charge after all other income. In the end, at the last, after non-saving, then saving, then dividend, and then consider the double A charge. Okay? Another rule. What is the annual allowance amount? Annual allowance. There is a limit of annual allowance. And if you see the tax sheet for 1920, their annual allowance limit is. Now, one important question. Is it fixed? Is it fixed? Yes. Yes. Student is saying yes. Anyone can add, this is fixed. That means it cannot be changed. It will remain 40,000 in each circumstances, or we might increase this or decrease that. Can we increase this value 40,000? Can we decrease this value 40,000? If yes, then what is the limit? You should know each and everything, right? If don't know, nothing, no problem. If right now, if you're not able to recall, no problem, nothing issue. Now, let me just tell you that if you are not able to, so what you can do is, I'll share my PowerPoint slides with you as well subsequently. If you are in need of that, this comprises of the tax rules. So let me just show you the few points that I'm just orally defining. Now, see this. This is my PowerPoint slide of pension income. Now you can see the rule. Restriction of annual allowance. This is the rule. And rule says that the annual allowance is gradually reduced for individual with high income. The restriction applies to individual with a threshold income of exceeding 1,10,000 and adjusted income exceeding 1,50,000. Both conditions must be satisfied. And if a condition has been satisfied, then annual allowance is to be reduced by the excess of adjusted income and 1,50,000 by half. And the maximum reduction, how much you can reduce by 30,000 so that the minimum value is fixed now. So from 40,000, it might be reduced to 10,000. Now this rule we have to apply in this question as well. Now, how we can calculate the adjusted income and threshold income? Threshold income and adjusted income. What is threshold income? Now the formula, you should know the formula. Net income minus gross personal pension contribution. This is threshold income. If your threshold income is less than 110,000, so do not calculate the other requirement. Just say that the annual allowance will not be reduced. It will remain at 40,000. So fine. This is the rule. I'm just showing you the rule that if you know the rule, then you can easily ask. Now let's see the requirement again. you have to calculate the reduction in income tax liability as a result of the contribution. You also explain the personal allowance. Now, this is the requirement. Do you think we have effectively identified what have been asked in all three parts? If yes, then we will start identifying the data from the question. Obviously, you will not do it in this way, like very slowly in the exam. For 20 marks question, you have 36 minutes. You can spend 40 minutes too, but in 40 minutes, effectively you have to cover that part, the A, B, C, right? So you have to be quick in reading the requirement, reading the question, take 5 to 8 minutes in planning, and then go ahead for 30 or 25 minutes to solve the relevant portion. Now, one question again. If you were in March 2020, do you think that this question is difficult as in terms of requirement? What is the difficulty level? Do you think that this is very difficult question, or do you think that this is very easy? And if I were the student, I can easily pass the paper on the basis of that question. What do you say, Zulfikar? Yes, she's saying that might contribute more or less. Okay, can get 10 marks out of 20. Sir, I'm lost in pension annual allowance charge. Okay, right. Okay, so from your answer, I'm just maybe A and B part. Why not C? I'm just worried about why not C. C is a easy issue. Pension contribution is not that difficult. Why not C? To me, A and B is difficult. C is comparatively less difficult. It has lots of calculation, but it's manageable. It might be consuming, time consuming, but you can get 10 out of 10. But in the A and B part, you might not able to get 10 out of 10. Well, it might be possible, like you might not understand the topic of pension clearly. Okay, fine. So meantime, just work out what I'm advising to you people. Try to get the relevant stuff right, so you'll be able to identify it correctly. I think personally, I advise personally students, practice few questions, but practice them in such a way that you will not forget what you have practiced. So practice, like, for example, you don't need to practice the whole kit, whole revision kit. You just have to just select few questions, few important questions, and then just focus on the requirement or something like that. Okay, let's just move to the question now. Let's just identify what is the related information regarding IHT, regarding property income, regarding the personal pension contribution. So this is the question. I'll take a 10 to 15 minutes break around 7:20 to 7:25 due to my prayer times. So in between, there will be a 10 to 15 minutes break, right? And today's session timing is 6 to 9:30, right? 6 to 9:30. and he'll try to solve the maximum of March 2020 today, and the leftover part we'll discuss tomorrow, right? Okay, let's move to the question. Let's read the question properly. Let's find out the relevant information. So who is Pedro? Mr. Pedro was given a holiday cottage by... So Pedro received this holiday cottage in UK by his aunt Marina in the year 2009. Is it a potential exempt transfer? Pet? Yes, just identify. Okay, what is this? Yes, it is a potentially exempt transfer. He paid inheritance tax in respect of this gift of the holiday cottage following Marina's death on 8 June 2019. So who is paying tax? Pedro is paying tax. And is also inherited a portfolio of UK furnished unfurnished properties valued at 6,70,000. So he received a holiday cottage, also received some unfurnished residential properties, right? Now, as far as the gift of holiday cottage is concerned, Marina and Pedro agreed that she could stay in the house. Now, this is a bit changed. The donor, that is Marina, will live in that house 2 months for each year, and that is rent free, which she did every year until her death. And for the remainder of each year, Marina lived in her main home. What is this? Is there a separate topic? What is this? Can you identify what topic is this? IHT. What specific issue is this? If you are able to highlight, you might write something. Now, very good. Perfect. Perfect. Very, very good. That is the requirement of GWR. That is the gift with reservation, right? Very good. Because if you are identifying it well, chances are that you can attempt it very well. Okay. So exactly your IHT is good, but your income tax is a bit down. Now, property income. So in the first part, what I have to deal? I have to deal the inheritance tax implication of a gift with reservation, right? During the life on death. So if you know the rule of gift with reservation exactly, it's these marks are easy. You have to explain that whether it's a potentially exempt transfer, whether you have to pay tax during lifetime on death at the time of death, or whether you have to pay it on death estate. Which option is better, right? GWR. And there is one condition as well where this GWR can be avoided. And that exception, but in this question, there's no need to write that exception, because the thing is that it has been mentioned that it's rent free. So already mentioned that it's rent free. Okay. Now let's see what is property income. The cottage, which is fully furnished. Now see, the question requirement says that whether this qualifies as a furnished holiday letting. So if the cottage is furnished, one of the requirement is the cottage must be furnished UK property and has been available for rental on commercial basis. This is the requirement, that it must be available for letting on a commercial basis, right? It's available since 1st July 2019. 1st July 2019. So in the tax year, it will have a 70% occupancy rate for the first year of trading. So just count the days from 1st July 2019 till 5th March. How many days in this tax year available? How much available? How many days are available? The rule says that your property must be available for how many days? What is the exact requirement? 210 days, right? The availability criteria. What is the availability criteria? The availability criteria says that the cottage is to be available for at least 210 days, right? So is it 210 days or less than that? So from July, August, September, October, November, December, Jan, Feb, and March. So it's 9 months. So it's 9 months. How many days in 9 months? Available for 240 days, right? You are saying 240 days. And I'm just calculating it from July, August, September, October, November, December, Jan, Feb, March, because it's 5th April, right? So it's 9 months, and 9 months means more than, it's available more than 210 days. So first condition is being satisfied, right? This is the first condition. First condition have been satisfied. So I will write the first condition, that is the availability, okay? The next is, no tenant will have stayed in the cottage. Achha, okay, fine. 70% is the availability. So what is the 70%? Is the occupancy, actual letting. So if this is 270 days, so what is the 70%? Is it is more than, the second requirement is actual letting. And actual letting must be greater than 105 days. So 70% occupancy is more than 105 days. That means second condition is also satisfied. Two conditions. And the rental income from the cottage is 14,500. So this is the source of income number one. In the tax year 1920. Now what you have to do? Just when you are attempting the computer based exam, use your scratch pad, notify all the important stuff from the question, just copy it down to the scratch pad, transfer that stuff to your answer sheet, and then plan your answer accordingly on the basis of the above information. And then at the end of the question, just delete that scratch pad notes because it is not being marked. I will tell you how to do that subsequently. Now, what is the third condition? What is the third condition? There is a third condition as well. Pattern of occupation. No customer will stay more than 14 days consecutively. So are we meeting the long-term occupation rule? We have to identify. So it says that no tenant will have stayed in the cottage for more than 14 days consecutive during the first year of trading. It means pattern of occupation says that it is not a long-term occupation. So from the question, we have identified the relevant information. Now, once again, just move to the question. Explain by reference to the relevant condition why the holiday cottage will qualify as furnished holiday letting for the first 12 months of trading. Now, what you have to do? Just to write the availability criteria, state the availability criteria, state the actual letting period criteria, state the pattern of occupation, discuss the long-term occupation rule, and you will get 5 out of 5. Right? Let me just to show you the marking scheme of this as well. Where is the question paper? So let me just show you the marking scheme of this particular question. 1 minute, just a minute. The marking scheme of this is that how examiner is distributing the marks, whether we are able to get that or not. Look, this is the marking scheme of question number 4. So this is the part B, the availability condition, the actual day letting, the pattern of occupancy, and the furnished commercial letting on the basis of UK. So this is the 5 marks. So if you have write the availability condition, actual letting condition, pattern of occupancy, and if you mention that it is a furnished commercial letting, so you can get the full marks, or you might get 3 out of 5, 4 out of 5, and you can easily do it within 2 minutes or so. Now, once again, let's move to the, is there any question right now? Because I'm just about to move towards my prayer times. So if you have any question, anything you want to discuss. Recording. Okay, let's begin. All of you are there. Okay, fine. So you can see that the rental income from this cottage is 14,500. This is one source of non-saving income. And then he also received rental income of 32,000 from the unfurnished residential property which he inherited from Marina. So that means Pedro has two sources of income. One is the rental income and other is the rental income from the unfurnished property. Now this information is useful when we'll apply the income tax liability. Okay, when we'll calculate income tax liability, then we need to know what is the property income, what is the employment income, double A charge, whatever we have studied so far. Now, another source of income for Pedro is Pedro has been employed by L Limited since 6th April 2018. He receives an annual salary of 75,000, another source of income, and he contributed 8,000 in each of the tax year. Now, this is very important. Because when we will calculate the annual allowance, so we have to see that in the past, how much has been contributed. So he has contributed, what is the question? 1 minute, let's see. Yes, 3 years, fine. So the rule says that contributed in 1819 and in 1920, also contributed to its occupational pension scheme. That means he is already contributing the occupational part, that is 8,000 and 8,000 in the relevant year. Now, as far as personal pension scheme information is concerned, this is very important. Pedro has never been a member of the scheme prior to taking up employment with L Limited. Pedro wishes to start contribution to personal pension scheme in 1920. This is the first year. Pedro intends to make his first contribution to the new scheme. How much? 85,000 gross. 85,000 gross. So if he is making this contribution, that the amount of relief, we have to identify the amount of relief as well. The annual allowance available was not restricted in previous year. Okay. Income tax liability for the tax year 19 and 20 before considering the contribution is 41,260. His income tax liability is already there, that is 41,260 before the pension contribution, right? And what we have to identify? The reduction in income tax liability. Okay. So we have to calculate the income tax liability again, and then we have to compare with the income tax liability of 41,260, and then we have to identify the amount of reduction. Okay. So this is the information pertaining to pension part. So let's solve it. Calculate the reduction in income tax liability. So we have to calculate the income tax liability again. So I'll use this information about the pension scheme and identify the income tax liability. So let me just have some working. Obviously, my main performer will show the income tax source of income, and then personal allowances, then taxable income, then income tax liability. So it will be the main performer, but I'll start compiling the working notes, which is necessary. So first of all, let me just check that how much contribution is available for relief. So we have to check that the amount of relief. Do you know what is the condition that how much amount is available? What do we have to do? First of all, we have to calculate the amount of relief. Anyone? How we can calculate amount of relief? Any idea? Its formula is higher of 3600 and 100% of relevant earning, and then compare this with the pension income. So you can see from the question that the relevant earning, you can see that relevant earning is more than that, the amount of contribution. So the amount of relief available will be exactly the 85,000. The full 85,000 will be available for the amount of relief. And you will start from this, the amount of relief calculation. So let's identify first the threshold income, because we have to see the annual allowance limit as well. So let's identify the threshold income first. The formula for threshold income is, that is net income minus gross personal pension. So this will be your threshold income. Now, what is the net income? In order to find out the net income, we have to see that we have employment income. It was given in the question as 75,000. We have property income. It was given in the question as property income was 14,500 plus 32,000. There are two property income, 14,500 plus 32,000, making a total of 46,500. And this way, our total income, which is the same as net income, this is 121,500. This is our total income. And from this total income, we'll deduct the available personal allowance. So it will be my taxable income. So I'll just calculate the personal allowance. But first of all, I'm interested to find out the threshold income. So the net income is 121,500. The gross personal pension is 85,000. If you see the net income, so the net income says that personal allowance will be reduced. But when we contribute contribution, then the threshold income and adjusted net income both will be reduced. And as a result, if you calculate 121,500 minus 85,000, so you can see you will get the figure of 36,500. So as threshold income is less than the required amount, so AA will be 40,000. It will not be reduced, and there is no need to calculate adjusted income. It's fine. I already show it to you in the pension notes that there is a limit of threshold income of 110,000. So if the income is less than that, the full 40,000 annual allowance is available, right? So we have determined that the annual allowance available is 40,000. Now let's identify how much annual allowance is available for 1920. So for 1920, the annual allowance available is 40,000 from the above working. You can show the working reference here. You can show the working and the unused double A. Now there are 3 years rule that if there is unused annual allowance from the previous 3 years, then you can utilize. But as far as the pension contribution is concerned, there was just two pension contribution previously. One is 1819 and another one is 1920, which is the current year. So in 1819, there was a contribution of 8,000. It means that in 1819, out of 40,000, we just utilized 8,000. So the remaining contribution is available to carry it forward for the 1920 is 30,000. So how much is the annual allowance available? That is 72,000. That is the available annual allowance. This is another working, the available annual allowance. Now another working, that is the double A charge. We have to see whether there is any double A charge or not. So how we can check whether there is double A charge or not? So for double A charge, we have to see how much is the contribution in the current year So we have contribution. One is occupational contribution, that is 8,000. Another is personal pension contribution, that is 85,000. So the total contribution in the year is 93,200 in the year 1920. And we have to compare this with the above figure, that is the annual allowance available. And that annual allowance is what? 72,000. So the rule says that if contribution is greater than annual allowance, what would happen? The excess amount is known as, this is called the double A charge. So one calculation, I have checked whether the annual allowance would be reduced or not. The second calculation, the current and previous annual allowance. And the third calculation is whether there is any double A charge or not. Now, this double A charge is to be considered as non-saving income. This considered as non-saving income and is a top slice of income. So we'll consider it at the end of our income tax liability. So what was the income tax pro forma? We have employment income, we have property income, we have total income. Now we need to calculate the personal allowance. Now as per the personal allowance rule, there are quite easy rule of personal allowances. So we have to see that how much personal allowance is available. And we have to explain it as well. So you can see that from the working, you can see that the net and adjusted net income formula says that the adjusted net income is also 36,500. So let me just explain the personal allowance rule. So I will just put the heading here. Personal allowance. As adjusted net income is 36,500. So full personal allowance is available. And how this figure, you can just write it down. You can mention that your ANI was, your net income was 121,500. 121,500. Your contribution was, personal pension was this. So as this is less than 100,000, so full personal allowance is available. So if full personal allowance is available, then I will write here how much personal allowance this year. It's 12,500. So out of 121,500, the taxable income is now 109,000, and we have also considered the double A charge as well. Now another thing, should I increase my band? Should I increase band? So this is extension of band. So my basic band will be extended by, will be now, how much? 37,500 is the limit. It's, you have to calculate the basic band. So it's 37,500 plus gross personal pension contribution. You can see that how much is the amount? 122,500. So now my band is 122,500 rather than it is 37,500. But if I put double A charge into this 109,000, if I'll put double A charge of 21,000, so it will exceed my basic rate band. So now let's calculate the income tax liability. There are chances that you might get some calculation, you might perform some calculation mistakes here because there are lots of calculation in this 10 marks question. So you have to be accurate in terms of the threshold income, in terms of ANI, in terms of AA, in terms of AA charge, and then the extension, and then finally income tax liability. So when you apply income tax liability, so it's my income tax liability 109,000. So non-saving income 109,000 falls in basic band, and the rate is 20%. Basic band rate is 20%. So what is the amount? If you calculate the 20% value, it will be, let me just calculate. Yes, I'm recording that session. So those who are late, those who are unable to join, we will provide you the recording as well. 21,800. So this is 21,800. Now the leftover is the band space is, the basic band is available till 122,500. So my double A charge partly fall in basic band and partly falls in the next the higher rate band. So the difference between these two is 13,500 and my double A charge is 21,000. So on this we'll apply basic rate 20%, that is 2700, and the remaining double A charge will apply. How much is remaining? 21,000 minus 13,500. So the remaining is 7,500. And the remaining amount is the higher rate 7,500 into 40%. So it will give us a figure of 3,000. So in this way, you can see what is the meaning of top slice of income. Double A charge, I have considered double A charge after considering employment income, property income altogether. So as a result, this says that my income tax liability is 27,500. So its income tax liability is 27,500. What was my previous liability? My previous liability was, where is that? My previous liability before planned contribution was 41,260. So reduction in liability. $41,260 minus $27,500. So in this way, we are able to get the benefit of putting contribution, excess contribution will give us a net benefit of 13,760. So this is what about the 10 marks personal pension contribution part. Done. All the calculation. You have to structure your working so that examiner will understand that where is the working, where is the main pro forma. So this is basically the main pro forma. This is the main income tax calculation and main pro forma, and all these are workings. Subsequent to this, if your working is correct, you will get the full 10 marks. So this is part C. Part B, I have already concluded part B and part C. Now, what about the part A, inheritance tax implication of the gift at the time when the gift was made and as a result of death? Keeping in mind, it is a gift with reservation. So if you know the rule, then the part A says that IHT lifetime and on death. You have to explain. No calculation is required. So as far as explanation is concerned, so we know that in case of gift with reservation, what is the rule? That particular holiday cottage is considered as a potentially exempt transfer. So you can write the requirement. You can write that this is considered as potentially exempt transfer, so no tax at the time of transfer. At the time of transfer, and check the date of transfer and the date of death. If it has been given, you can also mention that as well. The gift was given on 4th March 2009. And is there any information about the death of Marina? If there is an information, you can mention about whether 7 years rule has been... Okay, there is an information. There is an information. The death was on 8th June 2019. So we know the rule that, and no tax on death because death is 7 years after. Then you can mention that this is a gift with reservation because she is using that property and paying no rent. So, and also mention the point that the reservation was not lifted prior to her death. So if reservation is not lifted prior to her death, let me just to show you that as reservation is not lifted prior to her death, so we have to calculate tax as higher of considering PAT. Because the gift with reservation rule is there. So even 7 years has been passed, you have to mention this, considering PAT and tax on death estate. So if you write these two paragraph, if you explain all the points, then you can easily get the 5 marks about gift with reservation. Or you can add one or two lines about that, if the reservation is lifted prior to death, then what is the consequences? You can add one or two lines. You can also add about the available NRB. So you can say that if death estate is more than NRB, then there will be a tax liability. Otherwise, there will be no tax liability. So and so on. So I've just tried the basic rule of IHT on death and gift with reservation. So this is what an attempt of the March 2020 question number 4. Now, if you have any questions, what that is the requirement? What has been mentioned in the requirement? So you can see that the question 2 requirement is not.